For inviting me here and giving the opportunity to present the main finding of our recent OECD studies around open science and open data. My presentation will be much less technical than the others that just preceded me. I'm here to present the main finding of the recent OECD study, but actually this is not the first time that the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, is working on issues around data sharing and open science in general. Perhaps some of you may be familiar with the OECD recommendation dating back to 2007, where the OECD was actually developed principles to promote data sharing in OECD member countries. Between 2007 and now, many things have happened, and now I'm OECD committee, OECD expert group, the CSTP, the Committee for Science and Technology Policy at OECD, decided to get back to the issue of open science and open data. And this is why in 2013 and 2014, experts from OECD countries, together with OECD Secretariat, decided to come back and started to analyze recent policy trends around open science and open data in OECD countries and actually also. Yeah. This first study has come to an end, but actually, given the importance of the topic for many countries around the world, it is really likely that there will be some follow-up activities to study open science and open data policies even further. But why OECD countries decided to get back to the issue of open science and open data? The reason is simple, is that the scientific enterprise has evolved tremendously over the past year. Information and communication technologies, as all of us know, are offering new opportunities, new possibilities to the scientific enterprise, and science is becoming increasingly more data-driven. In the picture, you can see the number of papers related to TDM, text and data mining activities, and you can see that the papers containing data mining-related words have been actually booming since 2000. So this means that the scientific enterprise is really, really becoming more data-driven. Here you can see the nice picture of our report. This report contains policy messages around open science and open data. It is being approved this week from our countries, but it will be released soon, and it will be openly downloadable from our website. But what is open science, or at least what I've been focusing on in this report? There is no formal definition of open science, but in the studies we refer to those efforts by government, research funding agencies, and the scientific community in general to make the primary outputs of publicly funded research results publicly accessible in digital format with no or minimal restriction. We also focus on open data, and with respect to open data, we put the accent on both access and reuse of open research data. And I'm sure that the audience here are researchers, so I don't need to define with you what research data are. But in the report, we acknowledge the fact that open science is actually more than open access to publication and open access to data. We clearly state that it includes many aspects and stages of research processes, for example, collaborative research, algorithms, software, and methodologies. Member countries so far have been focusing on promoting open access to papers and data, but in the near future, perhaps they will have to try to understand what is the best way to promote a collaborative and open, a broad idea of open. But why do we care? Why do policymakers care about open science? They care about open science because it can make the scientific enterprise more efficient. It can actually make the scientific enterprise more transparent, and it can also promote better quality in science, for example, by allowing easier reproducibility of research results. It can speed the transfer of knowledge, and we have been seeing several examples here today. But it can also increase the knowledge spillovers, not only to the scientific enterprise itself, but also to other sectors of the economy, to innovation, for example. by sharing data, and again, we have some interesting examples to manipulate, companies or people can try to reuse this data to produce new services and create new businesses. But also, of course, open data and open science can be also a way to tackle global challenges more effectively. Climate change is one of them, but let's think also about the aging population, for example. And it can also promote a better, a faster engagement of citizens in scientific efforts. I'm saying so because we need to remember that open science is not a means in itself, but is an end towards something else, towards better efficiency in science, but also innovation and society in general. And we also need to remember that promoting openness is certainly very important, but at the same time, science is competitive, it's a competitive enterprise. So policymakers need also to realize when it's better to promote openness, but in some cases, they also need to remember that competition is important. As I was saying before, open science can also be important for companies and for businesses. And there are several examples that are telling us so. For example, when we look at downloads from public centers, it's not only researchers that are actually downloading these papers, but a good 17% of downloaders are coming from the business sector. And there's also evidence of the fact that SMEs and companies in general actually would like to use even more the outputs of scientific efforts. But in some cases, they cannot do it because these results are not always open and shareable with the end users in a free and open way. I was very glad to hear in some of the presentation before some analysis of the economic inputs of some open data efforts. Because even if many studies are out there, it's true that in some cases, the impacts of these policies need still to be carefully assessed. One of the reasons is that open science is a relatively new phenomenon, at least for policymakers, perhaps not for the researchers, but for policymakers it certainly is. And they often want to understand what is the evidence, what are the impacts that are actually baked back to these policies. But to do so, I mean, we still need to go to the road and try to carefully assess what would be the impact of this policy, since we know that many different estimates are out there, but often we see that these estimates are really large divide from one side to the other, and the reason is that assessing the impact of sharing research data is not easy, it's very difficult, there are a lot of externalities, and even the impacts need to be properly defined, because of course there will be impacts on the scientific enterprise, there will be impacts on the society, there will be impacts on the business sectors, but still we need some we need to think about really defining and measuring. What we have also been observing during the project is that the landscape of open science systems is really complex. We have very different types of actors involved, the researchers, of course, public entities such as governmental ministries, funders, as well as individual institutions, universities or public research organizations. We also have actors from the business community, for example, the private nonprofit that have been largely engaged in open data and open science efforts. Let's think about, for example, the Wellcome Trust or the Gates Foundation that have been recently releasing open science policies. And we also have actors belonging to the business community, such as public scientific publishers that have been engaging increasingly more in efforts to share data, to share research data, and also the business community itself, that can be an end user, so to use and reuse the data that is released and produced. But what you know is that all these different actors, they do not have necessarily the same goals and incentives. Therefore, countries, when developing an open data and open science strategy, they really need to try to understand what are the different conflicts between all these different incentives. So what we are highlighting in the report is, for example, that open science policies should not be the same for all, in all different cases. Openness is a continuum. So for example, the criteria that should be applied to push open science, where there are only public research actors in the game, should be, for example, different from the case where there are, for instance, public-private partnerships, because in that case, commercial interest can be at stake, and therefore different degrees, different criteria should be perhaps used. And what we are also highlighting is the importance of consultative approaches to really understand the different interests, the different goals, in order to make a good comprehensive strategy that is not causing too many conflicts among the actors. What we have been seeing in the last few years is that a very large number of OECD countries have become very active in releasing and actually promoting open science to define and adopt national open science development policies. This histogram is showing to you the responses to a survey that the OECD runs every 2 years. So we asked to policymakers in national ministries in OECD countries and beyond. I think this year we covered 48 countries. OECD countries are only 34. Where we are asking what are the hot issues in your countries around the science and technology policies. And you can see the red bar is open science, and it ranks quite high. Just below, I mean, much more broader questions around the national STI strategies and plan. So what we have seen is that over the past few years, open science has become a topic of great interest for our policy. But let me start a short tour of the world around open data policies, because we have seen that countries in really different, many different continents are pushing open data at the national level. For example, Chile, that joined UCD in 2010, now is actually developing legislation to comply with the UCD recommendations developed in 2007. China, since 2001, has been active in promoting the sharing to a scientific sharing program that involves different departments and different ministries in different fields, including the environment. Finland is a very advanced country with respect to open data and open science strategies. It has developed and is starting a fully-fledged strategy to promote data sharing and to promote also publication sharing of researchers in Finnish public research institutions. And they're putting a strong accent also on skills. The skill development of those scientists that have to share data, clean data, and reuse data, but also the skills needed in the society to actually use this data that have been released by the scientific community. In Germany, there's a working group focusing on research data. They have an initiative on digital information, and they have also developed some principles around the handling of all research data. Even in Germany, there's an attention on skills to promote data sharing. And also, there are some groups, like for example, the Helmholtz Association, that have been regularly organizing workshops and initiatives to develop more strongly an open science culture for the researchers in Germany. Even in Portugal, there's strong attention around data sharing. So the Foundation of Science and Technologies is actually trying to ask for data management plans, the researchers that are benefiting from grants from the institution. In the United Kingdom, again, another quite advanced country with respect to strategies for open science and open data, they also developed an open data institute. They have invested quite substantial amount of money to the machine. And even in the UK, there is a strong attention. For example, many UK universities are changing curricula in order to release degrees related to data management and data science to make sure that the society will be prepared in the future to actually take advantage of all this data that will be produced and used. And in the United States, I'm sure that most of you are fully familiar with the name of the OSCP, so I will not insist on that. But even in the US there is some attention about the sharing of digital data. Countries, in order to let's say implement the initiatives and the strategies I was talking before, are designing several instruments. We have seen that the majority of countries have been invested in developing the infrastructure, often national infrastructure, to promote data sharing, for example, repositories. They're also trying to promote data sharing cultures among researchers. And in some cases, they're also trying to change the legal framework around article and data to push even further open science. And I've been talking about this just before, and I'll be talking about it in the future. So, for example, I want to repeat what I've just said about Finland and the UK, but countries such as Germany or the UK, they have slightly amended national copyright legislations. In Germany, to allow researchers to share published research articles more freely, and the UK actually to promote even further text and data mining. And we know that in other OECD countries, such as Australia and the UK, there are currently discussions to see whether they could change in the future national copyright framework to promote open access and open data. In the report, what we're saying is that data-related skills development is absolutely essential. We have been seeing that although many countries have been starting investing quite considerable amount of money in repositories and other initiatives, developing skills for open data sharing has been less the focus of countries. So in the report, we are actually warning countries for this problem, because of course researchers can share the data out there, they can use repositories, but if the population or groups the population are not ready to use and reuse this data, of course the investment cannot be as good as it is. We also insist on the importance of having clear legal frameworks, and also of the fact that researchers need to be aware of these legal frameworks, because in some cases, by talking with different researchers in many different places, what we have heard is that sometimes the fact that they don't really know what they can do, or whether they can use and reuse, they can share this publication and this data, can be really a barrier for researchers to go forward in their sharing efforts. Training and awareness and raising awareness of researchers is also a key component of open data and open science strategies, because some researchers, as the one that are here today, may be fully aware of the possibilities offered by open data and open science, but not all researchers are equally engaged and equally aware of those possibilities. And also, finally, but extremely important, we have been seeing that really a good number of OECD countries are investing money with repositories, but perhaps they should care more attention in understanding whether the information that the repositories are containing is good enough for being shared and disseminated, because if the information is not clear, is not complete, or is not good enough, there's a risk that a limited number of users will actually really take advantage of this information in the future. We also have the incentives. Many countries are allocating budget in order to allow funding agencies to cover the costs associated to article and data sharing. And what we have observed is that, unfortunately, much less has been done with respect to carrots, in the sense of proper acknowledgement of open science efforts. Because as we know, in many cases, data cleaning and curation is an activity that actually takes a lot of time, it's time consuming. And we have been observing that almost in no countries, these activities are taken into account in national evaluation frameworks. So we need to really push for that, because incentives are certainly crucial. If researchers, especially those in the project that are less engaged, they don't understand why they need to do that, and they are not properly incentivized to do that, such a we may have an issue. And then, I mean, when nothing else works, we also have the sticks. So requirements that are often in research grant agreements. And in the case of a data chain, they cannot, for example, be requirements for having data management plans. And there are many member countries, many of the member countries that are actually starting asking for that in national. So let me skip this, even if another message that we are actually highlighting in the report is that now many countries are allocating budgets because open science has become a hot topic, but in some cases national administration, they're not carefully understanding the long-term preservation cost that needs to be associated not only to article sharing but also to data sharing. Sharing data and maintaining all these repositories and cleaning the data, preserving the data is certainly costly. So we think that the good business model still needs to be found. And in some cases, countries will have to understand what would be the best way also to engage the business community in this exercise. Perhaps national administration will not have the possibilities to do everything alone. So they will really need to find good business model to outsource some of the services, for example, to the private sector. And finally, open science and international efforts. We are here at UNESCO, an international organization that, together with others, such as the OECD, has been strongly engaged in pushing for open access and open data. But we also have seen the rising of many regional initiatives in Europe, for example. So, for example, La Referencia in Latin American countries, that is an international repository sponsored by the Inter-American Development Fund. And in the report, we are highlighting the importance of international collaboration around open science. For example, for issues like the one we have just discussed today, that is progress of global challenges. But certainly, international coordination and cooperation will also be very important in order to avoid duplication of efforts, duplication of national investment. To sum up, what we have been observing, and this will be some material for you to work even harder in the future, is that in general, policies to promote open data are much less mature than policies to promote open access to scientific publications worldwide. Well, I guess that we know why. The reason is simply that it's very easy to define a publication, and we can even catch it once we print it, except with an abstract index with the references. It is much more complicated to define a data set and data as an object. They can be really very different from one to another. I mean, there are very small data sets, there are huge data sets that are collected by machines. So, and I mean, data are much more complicated also because around data we may have privacy, confidentiality, and even national security issues. So let's say that national policymakers have been a little bit shyer with respect to national policies to promote or mandate data sharing, precisely because of this. Thank you very much for listening to my presentation. Just a very last piece of information, the report is being approved in these weeks by our countries, and it will be released soon. Through these linkages, the OECD World Bank Innovation Policy.com. And if you have more questions about the report or further and future OECD activities around open science and open data, feel free to contact. Thank you.
So, is there a quick question for you, Nick?
I'm just curious if you actually found any examples of public private. Were actually, started at any possibility of longevity. People talk about these. Haven't run across any actual.
I think that is. I have a very good question. Is there anybody from CERN in the room here? I think that there's a very interesting example of public-private partnership. It's actually more around open access to scientific publication and open access to data. At CERN, they put together, let's say, an station. And actually, they demonstrated, I think that you can even download somewhere from the internet the story about this project. It's called Scope 3. And they managed to actually decrease the article purchasing charges to this international competition. So I think it's an interesting example of course, you know, a powerful organization within the scientific enterprise that had, let's say, enough power to force publishers to compete. But through this cooperation and through this dialogue, for sure, I mean, at the end, the organization that is funded by public money managed to really, you know, decrease the cost that they had to spend to allocate and fund articles. So as I was saying before, it's really a new area of policymaking for many national administrations around the world. So I think that so far there are, say, less examples than what we would like to see, but probably the situation will change in the future also, because even the business sector is realizing that they will have, you know,